No problem, yeah, give it up for Jerry.
Yeah, I recognize a few names, I'm still, sorry. Try to make it more interesting, you can ask me some questions that we didn't answer last time. I did not bring slides, and I went after I saw this, because I didn't know we had any way of projecting them in this room. I went, oh, I got some pictures of some of my crazy adventures. But the bottom line of what I want to just talk to you about is, I have led a life that has never been born. And I believe, there's two critical things that I always believe, is that entrepreneurism is truly a mindset. It's truly the way you think about the world and how you approach everything in your life. So that's number one. And I've had that since I was quite young. And then the second thing that I learned along the way is that innovation is our most basic survival instinct we have as a human being. So without innovation, and I'm going to describe how I came to this place, but without innovation, we wouldn't have chairs. We wouldn't have lights. We wouldn't have cell phones. We wouldn't have anything we've got today. And so innovation has been what has let us survive as far as we have. And the reason I say that is I've lived through the evolution of man. I wonder what that might be. And Alex helped us write a bit of the story. So my husband and I had a dream to live off the land, off grid, both when we were kids and then we met later in life. We met when we were in our early 30s. And we talked immediately, the first time we met, sitting in a bar, we're actually at the Calgary Stampede, in a bar, we're both hammered, and we're talking about all the different adventures we've been on, and then we shared sort of this weird dream that we each had, was to go live off land. And I don't mean just live off land off grid, we meant live off land as our ancestors did. So we had this huge curiosity about hunter-gatherers and how man lived. So that's going to be part of the story of how I got to innovation. But the original part of the story, the entrepreneur part of the story, is I took nursing here at Queen's University and I hated every second of it. I knew I was in the completely wrong program for me. And so it's okay if you're feeling like the exact same thing. You're sitting in a program and you're like, Jesus, I want to do this goddamn job. When you get out. And when you start applying for jobs, you will see that even more. You're going to get out there, especially if you're in engineering and you've got sort of some bigger dreams, and you go and it's like this, you're going to sit in a cubicle and do something for every day, in and out, over and over again, designing something. And it's soul crushing, some of the jobs that are out there. And it's okay to go, oh, I don't want to do this forever and ever and ever. And so I knew I had to graduate from nursing because I was working full time as a waitress to put myself through school, and I knew I could not afford another year. I couldn't keep up the level of full time school, full time work to pay for everything to get me through another year. And so I had to finish nursing. So when you screw something up, and the reason I ended up in nursing, ladies in the room, I got accepted into engineering at Waterloo and architecture, my real love, at University of Ottawa. But my boyfriend was coming to Queen's. So I went, oh my God, well, I've got to get into something. Queen's, he's going to Queen's. And so at that late date, the only thing I could get into was nursing. Yes. First, So these things happen. We do make stupid decisions, and we've got to make the best of it. So what I did today, what is good about nursing? Anyone know anything good about nursing? It's a really hard, tough job. The job itself. But I love wellness. I love health, I love caring for people, but I hate the actual job. And what's great about nursing, back then, I could graduate and make more money than anybody else graduated. Because nursing, you started higher than everybody else. And then you never got a raise, hardly ever, after that. So in nursing, when I graduated, you started at around $70,000 a year, straight out of undergrad. Else is starting at 40s, 50s, and I'm at 70,000 a year. Nurses end their career 40 years later at a top out of 90,000. So that's a tiny little raise gradient over a 40-year career. But I could start high. I could get a job anywhere in the world, which is so cool. Because you always want to travel, and love traveling. Part of what I believe is part of what an entrepreneur loves to do is adventures and entrepreneurism and extreme things. It's something in your DNA. So I actually married the guy, my high school sweetheart, went to university, we got married, we moved out west, out to Calgary. And 2 years later, that was it. Walked out of the relationship, moved to Calgary, I had $200 to my name. And I moved to Calgary, and I knew not a single soul, and I actually lived in a homeless shelter for the first 3 months. And my dream was that I was going to have my own business, and I was never going to be reliant on anybody else for another dollar that I made, ever, ever again. That was the whole motivating driver. So at age 25, I started a home healthcare company. So I used the nursing, here's what I know best. Start a home healthcare company. Nothing about business, I didn't know pretty cool how to do any of it. And in 1 year, I had 75 employees. I was completely overwhelmed. I had not a clue what I was doing. I was an absolute nightmare boss. So if you've ever read Steve Jobs' story and how he treats people, that was me as well. I was cruel to people, I was mean, I was afraid. It was all my money, every dime I ever had. I'm living in a house that I bought on credit cards, this you guys can't do yet either. So the other thing about entrepreneurs, you're really good at figuring out ways around rules to still be within the law. But you can tell me what the rules are, and then, okay. So to get a house, I need a job. So I better get the house before I quit my job to start this business, number one. So the rules of credit cards back then were I could pay one credit card off other credit card and never pay any interest as long as I paid the other credit card off within 30 days. So my down payment was my credit cards, and every month I paid the other credit card, back to the other credit card, every 30 days, and I did that for 4 years before I ever started to pay that thing off and never paid a dime of interest. So get sneaky on how you bootstrap these things together. I got this big house and I got a mortgage. Oh my God, how am I gonna pay this? So way before Airbnb, I rented out every piece of that house. I rented out the basement as a basement suite, basically put a door on it and a tiny kitchenette. Basement suite, good luck. I rented out every room in the house. I had a new boyfriend at this time. He and I had one room and then shared living space, kitchen area with everyone else and bathroom. I rented out the garage, two-car garage to somebody who needed garage space. And I even rented my backyard for a neighbor who didn't have a fenced yard for his dog. So every single thing about this house I had rented out. That paid for, okay, that shelter. All right, now I need food. Oh my God, how am I going to get food? Okay, so I waitressed. So I waitressed on my way through school, and I thought, I can just keep waitressing. I make more money waitressing anyway. And time, I was also I had a boyfriend. I was also a bit of a serial dater, so I loved partying and I loved dates and I liked meeting guys. And so, how do you do that when you're starting a business? Waitress. And so I waitressed at a top nightclub in town. I wore a skimpy little outfit. I got drinks bought for me and I partied. So my partying, I was making money. So that's all social life. It's done. Bootstrap social life together. And okay, that's one need, another need taken care of. Food taken care of with the waitressing money. Okay, ready to start the business. now I have to bootstrap the business part too. So you bootstrap your life and then bootstrap the business. Couldn't find money. I went a year trying to find money and couldn't do it. A whole year dying, soul crushing job, dying while I'm trying to find money. So, and I actually had a, I went to a, because back then there's no angel investors at that point in time. There's no startup, there's no co-working spaces, there's no incubators, there's none of this, there's no pitch competitions. This is long before entrepreneurism was sexy. Everyone thought I was insane, absolutely insane. And I went to a bank, and that was the only place you could go then. I'd written up this detailed business plan that I had figured out from books in the library, how to write a business plan. I'd written financial statements, I didn't have a clue, it was all by hand, calculator. Excel then, and I go to the banker, and he says, this is, first I go meet him, give him a business plan, come back a week later. All right, this is the best business plan I've ever seen. Yes, it's the best business plan he's ever seen. This is going to be a very successful business. Oh, got it. Money is sealed. And then he says to me, young lady, first played that, oh shit. Young lady, you need to find yourself a husband with money, cut your hair, and start wearing makeup. Lay hair down to here. It was blonde, it was fair faucet light. It was massive. And I was just, I didn't even know what to say. I was just stunned. Showed up at work, the soul crushing job the next day, and said my story to a bunch of people there, and one other nurse says to me, I just got a jackpot. I just divorced my doctor husband. I took him for everything he's got. Yes. I've got money. What do you need? My own business launched. Based on someone got a divorce and had a bunch of money and didn't know what to do with it. And so she gave me the money. She came in as a co-founder. She didn't want to do anything with the business. It really was mine, but she put the money in and she helped me once in a while. And away I went. First business launched. Wildly successful, crazy woman, not a clue what I'm doing, angry, pissed off because every dime I've got, I'm bootstrapping everything that I own, and staff screw up, and people screw up. And you're afraid. Like, you are responsible for all these customers and all these employees, and you can't control every single thing. And all of a sudden, it starts to feel like it's not in your control because it's, well, booming, we're growing like this, and I don't know what the hell's going on, and I don't know how to do any of this stuff, and I'm hiring wrong, and I'm getting in trouble from the law, and it's like, I have lawsuits, and I didn't know what was going on, so I was pissed off. So anytime anyone screwed up or threw an issue in front of me, I was just like, crushing them, like just furious. And I had to learn, this is the way to run a business. So I got a business coach and I learned how to run a business properly and I calmed down. Business was wildly successful. We went national, we went across the country with the company as a franchise, and I sold it in my mid-30s. Yes, I'm like, entrepreneur god. Thought it was fabulous. I trip around the world. I like blew money like crazy. And back to MBA, which was not a smart thing to do. And I'm living high life, five star everywhere, every adventure you could think of, just like throwing money around. It was great. It was wonderful. Finished the MBA, start my second business, massive failure. Lost about 50% of my money. I like blowing money, big chunk of it. Shit. Okay, start the next business. Folded that one up. Anyone heard of a midnight move? Midnight moves are when you basically pack up your business at midnight and run from your office space quickly. You lay everybody off, you get the hell out of there, and it's called a midnight move. You talk to your lawyer the next day to say, please send letters to absolutely everybody related to me, all my suppliers. started a third business, massive failure. I am back to zero. I'm back to probably having to live in that homeless shelter again. So the nice thing was, I paid off the house. Thank God, back when I had the money. So at least I had a roof over my head. Lost the boyfriend along the way, because I was having too much fun at the bar. So I'm alone. I don't have a dime to my name again. And I've got to take a job. Which is why my original motivation was to never have to rely on somebody else to be my next dime. It was absolutely the most devastating feeling I have ever, ever had. But you got to survive. Unbelievably thrilling, even when it's in the nightmares. But I took a job. That job turned out to be the smartest thing I could have done. So I took a job with a company called CBI Health, which is used to be called Canadian Back Institute. It was owned by an American company, and they needed a Canadian arm to go on the stock exchange, New York Stock Exchange. So we were on the New York Stock Exchange, and I'm the director for Western operations. Good salary, doing great. The company, the US parent, is struggling. So they pull themselves off the New York Stock Exchange. While I'm working there for a year, I had sought out every entrepreneurial kind of person in the company and knew who they were. So then when they came off the New York Stock Exchange, I went to these people and said, we've got an opportunity here. They're a private company again. We can buy ourselves back. Let's get a venture capitalist and buy this thing and go nuts. So there were seven guys and myself, so eight of us in total. And we convinced a venture capital company to come on board because we were just such great operators and directors and we knew what we were doing with this company. And it was a good company. So this venture capital company, we did those. Now I have a clue on how to negotiate with venture capitalists, know how to do a Series A round. Totally learned it. Accidentally. The MBA, I had to actually shake the MBA off because I realized that it was part of what was screwing me up on those two ventures that I did in between. Two things that I did wrong. Thought too much, planned too much, analyzed too much, because I knew too much now. So don't think about it too much. Just start. Just start, which is what I did with the first one. And I had too much money. So in the first business, I was hungry, I was lean, and I had to make really difficult decisions at the time that I needed to make them. Or when you can throw more money at it, you don't make those tough decisions, you just keep throwing more money at it. So those are my two things I think were screwed up. So the fourth business now, we're all going, we've now got a venture capital on board, and divvy up all our jobs, and it was the first that I clued in, I don't have to be CEO. And this is a big blessing for founders. Everybody wants control. Everybody wants to be that CEO. Everybody wants to be in charge. Everybody wants to, I want to make the final decisions. They all want the big title. And what I had to realize is what I was great at was growth, national growth. That's what I did. very good friends today. We grew that business so rapidly that we went from about 800 employees when we bought it, and when I sold in 2007, we had 12,000 employees across Canada, and we were the largest, and still today are, the largest private health service company in Canada. I sit on the board still. I sold when the venture capital company sold out in 2007 because my husband, the guy I'd met, drunk at the bar, and I made a pact that night we met that we were going to go live off the land. And so how long do you wait to go do your dreams? I've done the entrepreneur dream. How much money is enough money to go live a dream? How much and when do we say go? So and it was really hard to make because this business with me, it was like a rocket ship. And it was exciting. We were making tons of money and it was phenomenal. But I really had to look at what dreams will I regret if I don't go do. And this was one thing. And we waited too long, it was gonna be too old. We needed to be young enough were still fit and physically able to go live on the land. So I sold out. We sold absolutely everything. He also had his own business in Calgary. So we sold all our businesses. We sold our incredible acreage outside of Calgary. We got rid of absolutely everything in 2007. And we walked away from the world we know. And we went and lived in the middle of nowhere in British Columbia. So we bought a little chunk of land, very cheap because it's in the middle of nowhere. We were 5 hours from the nearest community. Come on in. We were 5 hours from the nearest town, nearest store. 5 hours driving. But we're trying to live on land, so we don't want to go walking everywhere. We were an hour and a half drive to the nearest neighbor as well. And so we were surrounded, we were on the eastern slope of the mountains, and we were surrounded by wilderness. And we were about 75 kilometers off the maintained road, on like a little path you could get a vehicle in too. So we did have a vehicle there, but we said, okay, we're gonna build this earth ship. So we built, anyone know earth ships? They're one word. Check them out online. They are the most environmentally friendly home you can build. They are made of 80% recycled materials, primarily tires, with pounded dirt in them. And we sledgehammer the dirt into these tires, and they make these massive bricks that weigh about 400 pounds, and you build your entire foundation out of these tires. And then you bury the whole house, and you've got glass across the front. And it's south-facing. It's the most environmentally friendly house because of how it's built, but also because it's fully self-contained. So it's called a ship because everyone's needs are met by the house. So what eventually happens in this house is it's its own ecosystem. So the sun, your house is long and narrow, it's buried at the back with greenhouse out front. Two layers of glass, big huge glass up front, and glass sliding doors between us and the greenhouse, and the sun. So how do you figure out? So we'd never built anything in our life before. That's a crazy thing. One of the ways we figured out how to live in tune with the sun was, fun fact, where the full moon is in June is exactly where the sun will be December 21st, the shortest day of the year. So the month of June, full moon, right, full moon, and we took a pipe and we spotted it on the moon and then shone it back and got down on the ground and looked up, okay, full moon is here. We want it to shine across this far up the back wall of our house. The sun on December 21st. So by using the moon in this pipe, we figured out the angle of the front glass and the depth of the house to build, so that the entire entire house required no heating or cooling. It could be minus 30 outside and the sun was shining about here on our back wall, heating everything up. It would be minus 30 outside, we'd be plus 25 in the house and having to vent because the house managed to contain the heat so extremely well. And so no external heat source, so no carbon footprint. We had no waste at all. So the captured rainwater, funneled rainwater in that we used in the house, that water went into a gray water system. The gray water then watered all of our plants and food that we were producing. We also had, eventually, this is not at first, we had aqua fish. We had like fish in the gray water system. So they were pooping and then that water would go out into water and fertilize the plants. And then we eventually had chickens that would all above the fish in the pond that would poop to feed the fish. And so we never had to deal with any of this stuff. We had a composter toilet and plant in the food. Now that's gross to a lot of people, but that is actually what our food is grown in. It's poop. It's fertilizer. Fertilizer comes from organic waste, mostly from cattle and horses, etc. And urine is the top thing that tomatoes love. And nitrogen in your waste. So your entire house is designed around this living, breathing ecosystem that takes care of itself. But first year, all we know is a shell. We have dirt floors, tile, dirt walls, and the glass at the front. We got shelter. Yay! We were safe from the elements. And then we said, okay, now we gotta go live the dream. We don't have time to keep fancying up the house and building all these other things and all the systems. We are gonna go live as hunter-gatherers. So we, that spring, we spent 2 years living fully as hunter-gatherers. We never bought a single thing. We ate only what we could hunt and gather. And we almost starved many, many, many times. We needed salt desperately. So this is where nursing also comes in really handy. I understood the calories we needed, I understood what we needed for health-wise. I could take care of us if something happened. And I understood when we were getting low on salt. Not rolling salt, we didn't have salt because we didn't buy anything. When our body started to cramp, and I was like, okay, what causes muscle cramping, rotating muscle cramping? Our electrolytes are going out of whack. We need more salt than we're getting from our current diet. So we hiked through the entire Post Mountain Range, from the eastern slope all the way through to the western slope to the ocean. It's a long, long way. There are no trails where we're living. We're bushwhacking the whole way. And there's nobody around for hundreds and hundreds of kilometers. You want to feel alone and completely vulnerable? Go hike through the Coast Mountain Range where there's nobody around. Took us 15 days to get there. We had thought we'd be 8. And I had dried all our food and packed it all and calculated all the calories we were going to need. And off we went. And thank God, we had enough food. We started rationing the last couple of days, but we made it there. And we gathered all the seaweed, and we dried all that, and we gathered all the seafood, and we fished, and we, yay, we rejoiced with food, and dried everything, stayed on the coast for a while, and then headed back with all our dried salt items. And lots of fish to make back through the mountains. So this was so hard. Every second we thought about food. Every single second we were worried about food as a hunter-gatherer. We were worried about finding the food, getting the food, preserving the food, prepping the food, eating the food, restoring the food. Do we have enough food for winter? It's just food. And so our ancestors get out of that situation, thank God they were innovative, was all we could say. Because we then started to add in, and in hindsight, ended up realizing we lived the evolution of man. We didn't realize it at the time, but then we did the, okay, we just can't keep doing this. All right, let's add in farming.
Yay, start farming.
Started doing some farm stuff, we got crops, we made soil, we got some seeds, and we started farming. Then we started trading. So now we walk to some of our neighbor's place, trade stuff with them, and come back home. Then we got solar and wind power. Now we entered the industrial age. And we added a greenhouse. Then we added, okay, the greenhouse is not working, but the greenhouse, we had soil and it was a pain in the ass. It was hard to work in. What could be easier? So we went to hydroponics. We grew all our food by hydroponics. Yes, it worked. Then we got the filters working, and then my husband automated the entire house. And once we had solar and wind, we also had internet. Now we're reading and learning all this stuff, and we automated the entire house. The entire house took care of itself and produced food for us and clean water for us without us doing a single thing. We now travel. We are free to have culture and think and do other things, and we had no expenses, no carbon footprint, and all our food and water was provided and shelter. It's great. Hike in, bike in, take pictures, and now we start to travel. And we come home 2 months later, and all of our food was there, and we were good to go. So the ecosystem took care of itself. So we ended up living more futuristic than current society does. And through that process, we went, oh my God. We went away environmentalists. That was another thing that messed us up. We were hardcore environmentalists, tree-hugging people. Part of us was burned out in the life that we're living in this capitalistic world, and everybody's like out for the next buck. And we were pissed at what the world was doing to the planet. So it's part of why we went, have a job, a dream. And so what we realized through this whole process is the environmentalists have it all along. This is, we cannot go back. You do not want to go back and live through those eras. Believe me. There's good things about each of those eras that we recognize, but holy shit, it is hard. And so we realized that innovation is spectacular. But we didn't have a chair for 2 years. First time we sat in a chair again, after 2 years of no chairs, oh my God, this is the most amazing experience. A shower, just phenomenal. We were chipping ice away and swimming to clean, get clean. Like a shower, gosh, spectacular. So one, we start to appreciate everything we've innovated again. We realize that we can't stop what's innovating, because every innovation, there's a bad thing that comes with it. Every cool innovation that fixes something, there is a side effect of it. There is something negative that it also creates. And you can't always predict what that negative is going to be. If you think of oil and gas, everybody's vilifying oil and gas companies, they're all rotten and they're all terrible. There are some awful CEOs that are ruthlessly greedy people in the oil and gas industry. But it isn't oil and gas that needs to get vilified. We wouldn't have cell phones without oil and gas. Like, oh my God. We wouldn't have social media. We wouldn't have the internet. We wouldn't have a way to communicate like we do today. And so we, by the end of this journey in innovation, we went, oh my God, the world needs to think differently. We can't be fighting all this stuff. We must innovate. We've got to go back. We've got to be entrepreneurs again. We've got to find a way to keep innovation going. And we And so, the environmentalists don't have a right, the capitalists don't have a right, the government doesn't have a right. We need innovation, and we need entrepreneurs. So we came back with this whole different message, back to the world. And that was late 2014, when we came out of the bush. We came back to Kingston because of an aging house. So Kingston would not have been our first pick. It would have been probably where we would have gone. But my parents were here, and they were old, and they needed me. So we came back to Kingston. I found my way to Queens and said, I have this weird background. I don't want to do a startup right away because I'm supposed to be taking care of my parents, and I'm sitting in Kingston. Is there something I can do while I'm here, just to keep me from being not bullied? And so anyway, they went, oh my God, just start this program called Masters of Management, or Master, at the time, it was Masters of Entrepreneurship and Innovation. It's now called Masters of Management, Innovation and Entrepreneurship. And they said, Jesus, like, okay, been an entrepreneur. Done this incredibly innovative adventure. Perfect. Okay, sure, sounds good. So that's what I've been doing, is building this program. I came in when it was about 8 months old and completely revamped it. Went, oh, God, you guys, your MBA means people to death. This is not what entrepreneurs want to hear. This is not the way to teach an entrepreneur. We need to change this program. So I've done an entire now corporate innovation project to fix that program. It's spectacular. We've got 64 people in the program today, only 2 years later, and they are incredibly great, doing amazing things, and they're a group of people that will change the world. And one of the MBA faculty who taught for the first time in September with the class, she's taught for 25 years in the MBA, and she came out of the class after her first class, and she said, to us in the hallway, she said, the world needs more people like those that are sitting in that room. She's taught 25 years in the day. And what she meant and why she was saying that was because those entrepreneurs and innovators are, there's an energy about you. It's a lifestyle. There's a feeling that I know an entrepreneur as soon as I start talking to them. There's an energy, there's an excitement, there's a curiosity about life, there's a want to experiment, want to go do crazy things like I've done, want to go try weird and unusual things and experiment with their life. They think and know that they can change the world. And they will. And that is the primary thing that they want in their past. And so, long as we mess, I started to understand. I said I wasn't going to do it. I got roped into it, started in a startup, and I'm proud to say that the company is 18 months old, and we had a Series A round just before Christmas of $10 million. So we are launched again, and I turned down the CEO job. Bring it back to the story of what was all pork business, didn't take that position. Offered it this time, and I turned it down because I do not want to regret not leaving it in my past. And so part of what your decisions in life have to include is what will you regret if you didn't do it? And that includes really spectacular, fun, cool, exciting things you might regret, but it also includes really hard decisions, tough things that you have to do, so you do not leave the world with any regrets. Not caring for my parents would have done that. So the company, I'm still an investor in it, still have 15% of the company, I'm still on the board, I'll watch it flourish. And when my parents have finished this journey, then I will be ready to go again on my next venture. That is an entrepreneur's journey. It's never stop doing exciting things and the things you can think of in your head. Just go do them. You will survive. And you need to get a really strong belief inside you that you will always be okay. I have never once stung by scorpions along with them, and I saw babies born, and people died, and I've lived through that. And then we went and lived in the jungles as well. So we also lived with a Mayan family in Belize, Guatemala. We lived off the jungle, so we learned how to survive in the jungle as well. And so part of what makes your journey is making sure you know that you will be okay. And my husband and I needed some extreme experiences to say that we'll be okay no matter what happens. And questions? Definitely, especially when you're pushing every limit in your life, which is really what an entrepreneur is always doing, you get incredible highs and incredible lows. And when I was in my 20s, I did look at people and go, they're just, and even today, people that just live their life and everything's cool and they've got a job forever and they've got two kids and everything's fine and their life's this. And I would have lost many times to look at them and go, not wanting to do something else, figure something else out, do some other exciting thing. Why can't I just be okay? Entrepreneurs are not. And what I always say to myself is, oh my God, I would die that way. And if you never experience a high, you don't know when you're really, really low. And when you're really, really low, if you've never experienced that high, you don't know what to seek, what to go for. And so I love that I've had extreme highs and extreme lows. But the extreme lows are really low. When my third business failed, my Dave, how long we've been together now, 21 years, we had to move in his parents' basement. And I've traveled the world, and I'm living in my boyfriend's basement. And I was so depressed, severely depressed. But all I kept saying to myself is, this will pass, this will pass. Everything is temporary. I'm going to be okay. I'm going to be okay. It was the hardest time for me to say I'm going to be okay. But I'm okay has been my mantra. Everything is temporary, is the mantra I use in my brain. Everything is temporary, even the high. So don't let your ego get out of control, I did a few times, when you hit the high, because it is temporary. Everything in life is temporary. So even when you're making decisions, it's temporary. Yep, you made a decision to take whatever you did for your undergrad, you can change your mind. Every decision